Yes, good morning, everybody. On behalf of KLN College of Engineering, I welcome you all to this webinar on trends and opportunities in VLSI design. And for this webinar, we have three experts, and I'm very proud to say that all the three experts are my classmates. They are our college alumni, 94 to 98 EEE department batch. And I'm very happy to introduce Mr. Satish Abraham Selvaraj. He is working as R&D manager, Broadcom International Private Limited in Singapore. And I am very happy to introduce Balaji Gopalswamy. Mr. Balaji, he is working as senior manager, R&D, Broadcom India Research Private Limited in Bangalore. And I am very proud to welcome Mr. Sankaran Ramaswamy. He is working as engineering director, Blueberry Semiconductor Private Limited, Bangalore. And I hope all the EEE students are well aware of Mr. Balaji and Mr. Sankaran. They were the chief guests of their department symposium conducted in the last semester. Once again, on behalf of KLN College of Engineering, I'm very happy to introduce our chief guest, all the three chief guests. Please take on.
So the one question, so the students are from which year who are participating in this webinar?
Actually, the students from EEE department are third year EEE, and from CSE they are second years. Okay. And both the department students have studied digital circuits. In EEE they have studied digital circuits, and CSE they have studied digital principles and systems design.
Yeah, so for this VLSI to understand now, so they should have some background on digital knowledge actually to understand what it is and what we are talking about. So,
okay, so so what is next, Veda? Can we get started?
We can start.
Yes, you can start.
Balaji?
Yeah, yes, I will. Hi, my name is Balaji. So I am working as a senior manager in Broadcom India. So I will be starting this present webinar on trends and opportunities in VLSI design. Before that, I am thankful to Mr. Kannan sir and Mrs. Vedavadi madam for arranging this webinar and giving us opportunity to give you an overview of the industry trends and also like guide you through your questions if you want to get into this domain. Yeah, so coming back to introduction, so VLSI, so what does that VLSI mean? So VLSI is that like it is a very large scale integration of transistors, so that is called VLSI. So if you look at like how the evolution of the VLSI happened over last probably 70 to 80 years is that like around 1947 we invented first transistor. Okay, so from that we built radios and communication, start building communication systems using those transistors. So when we invented transistor, and then if you want to build a system with the transistors, it became bulky. So and the movement, carrying forward, everything is difficult. Okay. So over the evolution, they started integrating transistors into a silicon called chip. So when we integrate more transistors into a chip, that's where the integration of transistors means. And initially they integrated like few components of transistors, so that is called small scale integration. And then within the technology advanced, then they integrated few more transistors in terms of 100 to 1000, that became medium scale integration. So the small scale integration are like whatever you will be using in your labs, like logic gates, AND gate, OR gate, OR counters, OR multiplexer. So you will be using these components in your breadboard for doing your lab experiments in digital electronics or or microprocessor, digital electronics lab. So as technology more and more advanced, they are able to pack more transistors into the chip. That's where it become like a large scale integration, a very large scale integration of which the chip becomes more functionality, and we can pack more things into the same chip. And if you look at large scale integration, so whatever you are using, that microprocessor lab, your microprocessor kit, no, so that 8085, or if you have ARM microcontrollers, so those are like small scale integration, like little large scale integration. And if you have billions of transistors into a single chip, that's where it is a large scale integration. And when you integrate billions of transistors into a single chip in a small space, there are a lot of issues come up. So we need a lot of people needed to resolve those issues and to make it as a product. So that's where the job opportunities kind of evolved over a period of time. And it has become a big domain now, as a separate domain with the multi-billion dollar industry, where which is like a primary fast growing industry in the world for the past 30 years. So that is the background of the industry. So if you look at the picture, like from 1940 to 50 small transistor to minor chips and gate, OR gate, then to the processor, and then DSP processor in the 80s, and then it came to a 90s, 80s ASICs and FPGA, and now in the last 20 years we are doing mostly SoCs, where lot of functionality is packed into a single chip. Yeah, we can move to the next slide. Okay. So what is the reason that why we need VLSI? Okay, so obvious reason is that we want to lower the cost of the machine. Okay, if you look at those videos, like how it is evolved, like big computer, first computer to the laptop in your hand right now, so how much functionality is got into that chip, you can understand. And in the down figure, you can see that there is a 5 MB hard drive, which is kind of how it is getting transported, which is kind of how huge cost at that time. 1942, now we have a disk, which is like 3 terabyte, 4 terabyte of disk in a kind of a small size diary. So you can see the transformation of the technology from big size to the small size. That is the main advantage of when the size becomes smaller, when we pack more components, the cost and when we manufacture it in mass scale, then the cost becomes less, so that it is affordable to everyone. And also, when we get more components into smaller space, okay, and we can increase the speed, the way the device operates, and also with the amount of integration and the technology, we can lower the power. So right now, the power is for a semiconductor, no, power is a big motivating factor to integrate many components into a single, so that the overall power consumption is less. Like you want your phone battery to last for few hours to few days actually. So our goal is to to reduce the power consumption that chip takes, so that you can use the phone long hours of time. So that is another area where the VLSI industry contributes. we can go to the next slide. Okay, so coming back to, so how much we are integrating right now, like there is a empirical formula kind of thing given by the Intel founder Mr. Gordon Moore, which he told that like approximately for every 18 months the number of transistor counts in a chip doubles. Okay, and we are like in the past 40 years we are almost like meeting that trend, showing that like over a period of like 18 months we are almost able to double the transistor count which goes into a chip. Like in this case from 100, so this gives you a number of transistor count in a millimeter square of the chip, square millimeter chip. And from 100 transistors in a single chip, now we have like in a square meter, we have 100 million of transistor in a single square millimeter of a chip. So that is what this VLSI technology is able to achieve. So this is kind of a current largest chip in the world, which this chip is made of a single wafer, which is made of 1.2 trillion transistors. It contains 1.2 trillion transistors with 400,000 cores, like a CPU cores, in a 46,000 square millimeter wafer. So this is the scale which we are talking about now. It is this chip itself is a supercomputer in its functionality. So coming back to applications of the VLSI industry, so VLSI industry is where and all it is contributing. So the main things which you know is consumer electronics, which you currently use in your mobile phones and IoT devices. So whatever the major contributor for consumer electronics these days is like VLSI industry. And in terms of like then the other applications are like networking, like in your college campus, or you are having like all your computers are interconnected using LAN network. So the chip which is routing the traffic within the campus in a LAN network is a VLSI chip. Okay. And similarly, like whatever the mobile phones you are talking, and it has both application processor and baseband processor, and whatever the mobile towers where they have a baseband equipment, that is made up of VLSI technology. And another components are like it is used in like automotive devices. This is one of the emerging fields in the VLSI industry where lot of electronics is getting into the automobile. Right now, if you see, like compared to old 1990s Maruti cars and now the current cars comes, you can see how much of electronics, you gadgets and the securities you will get in that. All are like is possible because of the miniaturization of the chip and then low power consumption, and also due to the advancement of the VLSI. So another places where it is getting used is aerospace, defense industries, where the flight controls and other defense components are like made of VLSI chips, specific to their needs. Okay, and another field which is contributing is the medical electronics, and then the current growing field is a data center and supercomputer. So now like everything we talk about cloud, okay, so like this Zoom meeting is happening through a cloud, and similarly like with the COVID pandemic, no, so we are all doing from work from home, and we access using company network using VPN and cloud, where the mass storages are at place, which is provided by big vendors like Google, Microsoft, Amazon, okay, and we use their services to communicate. So, and they, all those data center servers are made up of VLSI chips. So, if you think about current life, now each and every minute of your life is now is kind of dictated by the VLSI industry. And going by the industry, look, no, so the VLSI industry was around like $10-15 billion in around the 1980s, and over a period of 2020, no, so the number of industry VLSI industry has grown near to $450 billion to $500 billion. There is a slight dip in past 2 years because of the uncertainties in the market. But over a long period, it is growing consistently year to year. Because of this growth, we are getting a lot of job opportunities. The VLSI industry in India boomed around from 2000 onwards, where there are a lot of companies started setting up their shops in design centers in India, and they started recruiting people from all over the country. So initially they used to recruit from around 1990s, 1995s, they used to recruit from people from like reputed institutions, and then when the growth demand happened around 2000, then a lot of training institutes mushroomed, and people through that training institute got trained and got into the VLSI industry. So when we came out around 98, around that time frame, no? So different people took up some people went into software, some people went into production manufacturing side, and we had an idea of we want to get into this field. We got interested into this, and then there are a few institutes offering that courses, and we studied that, and we kind of struggled for 1 or 2 years to get into a job. And then after that, once you get the experience, then you get to more know about multiple things, and you get to know about work on the latest technology in the world, which is happening right now. Currently we'll go to that. So from the basic introduction to VLSI, now we will work on how is the basic VLSI design process works. What is the VLSI design process? How we start making a chip? So on what basis we make a chip? The first step in making a chip is that to come up with this specification. What is the chip functionality? So how this chip functionality is derived? So there is in every company, there is a team called marketing team. So the marketing team interact with the customers. And they try to understand what is the difficulties they are having in using the previous version of the chip, or what are the good things they have, what are the difficulties they have, or what are they want to improve. So they collect these details, the marketing team collect these details from the customers who are using the existing products, and then based on that, so customer feedback, they sell that I want this extra functionality in the chip to take advantage of their competitors. So they tell the marketing team that, if you in the next version of your chip, if you have this functionality, it will be better. Okay. And then some customers will give feedback that I have too many components in the board, so I want to reduce the board cost. I want all these 4 chips to be functional in a single chip. So what we need to do is that we need to do a feasibility, whether all those components can be put into a single chip. And then if that can be put into a single chip, how it has to be interconnected within the chip itself, whether there is a feasibility. So they will do that analysis and then come up with the chip specification. So after once the chips marketing team comes up with a specification, they give it to a team called architecture team. Yeah, we can go to the next. So the architecture team decides like to achieve that if the customer say want some functionality, okay. So say for example, I want to display this video. So that say that earlier the videos are not displayed in mobile phones, okay. In the initial mobile phones, the videos are not displayed. So when they get the feedback from the customer, so I want to be a first company in the world to display a video on mobile phone. So I want a video chip in a mobile chip. Okay. So then the architecture team decides like if you want to make a video in a video display a video in chip, what are the components you need? Like what kind of processing, video processing you need to do to make a chip, video on the chip. Okay. Play a video on the chip. So based on that, they will select all the components. Suppose if you want to play a video on the chip, so you want a graphics processor. So they will decide the graphics processor. And if you want to play the video, you need a display. Okay. And to connect to the video engine and display, you need an interface. So for that interface, you need to come. How do we all these components communicate? So all of the technology has to be defined by the architecture team. So once the architecture team defines the technology, so then we have to validate that whether whatever the architecture definition what they put, whether it is really can work or not. Okay, so for that first we develop something called behavioral models. Like if you give these inputs, if you give this output with the certain types of constraints to make sure whether if that can happen or not. So using these behavioral models, you will be able to validate your architecture specification. You can go to next. So once you validated your specification using behavioral models, then you start implementing that solution into the design phase. So what design phase is that? It is called RTL coding. So register transfer level design. So in the register transfer level design, so whatever the architecture team defined the component, no? Like suppose if it is a graphics processor, okay. So to achieve the graphics processing, what kind of engines or logic I need to have. So that logic you need to capture in a high level definition logic. Like if I give these inputs, I will get this output. So that kind of definition you need to capture in a high level specification language. That is called RTL coding. So we'll go more details into these steps in the next slides. So once RTL coding is done, then you get into a next stage. Like so designers code the RTL coding, assuming that this will give input and this will output. So the next job is verification, where we need to make that the RTL coding is matching the specification. Whatever they captured as a design intent is really done correctly. So what we need to do is that based on the specification, we need to generate a stimulus generation and give it to the RTL design and put a monitor at the output and check that it is whatever input is whatever the output we got is based on the expectation. So that is called verification. So from the verification, we go into like pre-silicon validation. When a lot of components get integrated, no? So verification has limitations. Like we can't run real software before silicon. Okay. So the pre-silicon validation, there are now emulation or FPGA platforms where you can convert your existing design, put into FPGA, and then validate before going into actual production whether all the functionality, like if it is a graphics engine, whether it is displaying that video or not. We can see in real time saying that, like, whatever I designed is like working correctly before actually going into production. So this avoids, like, this helps in two things. You want to validate your software before actually getting the silicon, and then also, like, you can validate your chip in a real application. So after pre-silicon validation, so right now we have captured everything in a high level languages. Okay, so now to make it into a chip, you want to, in terms of logic gates, then only it can be manufactured into a chip. So there is a process called synthesis, where if you give your RTL design, the tool can take it and convert in terms of logic gates. So once that logic gates are given, then you can map it into a real AND gate or OR gate or flip flop or a latch or a multiplexer or adder, which we have studied in digital design. No, so you can map it to each of those. The synthesis is a process where you take your high level language description and convert into in terms of lower level components, which we studied in digital electronics. So to become a VLSI engineer, so the basic things you need to be thorough is in your digital design fundamentals. So once if you are well versed with your digital design fundamentals, then only you will be able to visualize your RTL design, like based on this input. If you want to get this output, what kind of components I need to put to get that output. So that is the intelligence where the people are involved. So that is the during verification also, you need to have a knowledge of the digital design, where if inputs are given, these outputs are coming. So if it is something coming wrong, what it has gone wrong, so you should need to debug that one. So for both of these things, you need digital design knowledge in very thoroughly. So in verification, if there are bugs, if you found, then you will again go through that a process, then pre-silicon validation and synthesis. So you can go to the next. So once you synthesis, then you convert in terms of gates, and then you did a simulation with the high level language, whether my input outputs are correct, and now you have components in terms of gates. Okay, so now you can simulate using the same verification flow. You can simulate the same input output in terms of gates and make sure that after synthesis also your input outputs are matching correctly. So after gate level simulation, there is a process called DFT insertion, which happens where once the chip after manufacturing comes, we want to make sure that the chip is defect free. So if a chip does not work, you will not buy the chip. Okay, so every component in the chip, no, so we need to make sure that that is defect free. So for that, we insert certain amount of logic to make sure that the chip is defect free. So that we will cover it in the next slide. So after the DFT insertion, then there is a floor planning, which we call it is a physical design cycle, where we map these gates into a real silicon, where these components needs to be placed. So all these steps will be covered in detail by Satish in following slides. So we have floor planning. Satish, you want to go through this?
Okay. So for the floor planning, the key thing that you need take note about the floor planning, this is the size of your die, this is the size of your chip. Okay. So given the area, so you have to make sure that you have to fit all the designs into this floor planning. Okay. So floor planning basically let's say if your chip has a lot of IPs, like, you know, DDR5, a lot of IOs, PLLs, and it has, you know, like 100 millions of gates, everything you have to nicely place it inside this floor plan and make sure that the design can able to fit the given area. So the problem, most of the time, what we face, you know, the PCB board is actually fixed, meaning there are a lot of components in the PCB board, and, you know, there's a small area for you to place your chip as well. So if the design can't able to fit within the given area, then you're going to have a problem, okay? So the key thing in the floor planning, we need to make sure that the design is fit. You have to find the optimum placement for all the components to be placed perfectly so that, you know, the area can be optimized nicely. So that's what we do in the floor planning. I talk more in details when it comes to the, you know, the physical design side. Next is the placement. So floor planning, we do like two things. One is like nowadays the design is so huge, so we go with the hierarchical design as well. So floor planning, we do top level and also for the block level. So once the top level of floor planning is done, you know, we will give the partition design to all the block designers, like, you know, how you do the RTL coding for each and every sub-blocks. We also do the same thing for the physical design as well. We take the small block, then we will make sure that, like, you know, the small block, all the gates are placed nicely, and then the placement density is okay. For example, like, Lene, for my block, I have a 5 million gates, right? But I have given an area of, like, you know, 2 millimeter square. Can I able to place all the cells in this 5 millimeter square or like 2 millimeter square area? So that's what we want to check in the placement step. So once the placement step is done, then we move on to the routing. So routing is basically like, you know, you are making a physical connection from one cell to the another cell. Like, you know, Balaji mentioned here, you have like buffer, inverters, you know, flip-flop, latches, all the max adder, stuff like that, all kind of cells, logics, right? So whatever you did in the past is actually the logical connections. So now you have to make the physical connections, the proper metal layers. You need to connect from one cell to the another cell, right? Buffer, you have one input and one output. Inverter also, we have one input and one output. If you look at the AND gate, we have a two input, one output. Nowadays, we have a multi-bit, you know, multi-input AND gates also in the latest technology. So all the pins need to be properly connected. So that's what the routing step will do. Okay, so once the routing is done, we do the clock tree synthesis. Basically, I think you all know what is clock, right? So clock is the same as, like, you know, if you're targeting, like, you know, 2.4 gig speed for your design. So that is defined by your clock. So clock is basically synchronize the entire design. Okay, and also it just coordinate all the actions happening, you know, within the design as well. So clock is very important. So the clock tree synthesis actually is one of the key thing in the physical design, I can say, because nowadays, you know, the clocks are so fast and you need to have a proper routing and proper balancing to achieve the better insertion delay. The insertion delay, when I say, is actually the latency and also the skew. So we'll see more details in the later slide, but we do the CTS after the routing step. Okay, and then we do the static timing analysis, right? So whatever we have designed so far, we need to go and make sure that my design is met that my constraints, right? So you have some specific constraints. Let's say if you take a CPU as a chip, how is my CPU and how many latencies, you know, I can have from one read access and maybe one write access, you know, how many latencies are required. So am I meeting that timing requirements or not? So whether my physical design or my RTL codings are really meeting my timing performance here. So we do the timing analysis, make sure that my chip met the timing requirement. Okay. So once the timing is done, then only we go for the physical layout. But let's say if my timing is not met, so what I supposed to do? Like here, we just put, you know, we're going back to the placement. Sometimes you may need to go back all the way to the floor planning stage. And also, there's going to be a lot of interaction between the physical design team versus the RTL designer. Say, hey, you know, I have so much of complex design in my chip, which, you know, I feel I can't able to route properly. Maybe I can't able to place properly. So can you please look into the RTL coding and see, is there any way you can improve further, you know, in terms of the coding style and better optimized way? So we have a lot of interaction between the front-end designer versus the back-end designer. And also nowadays the EDA commercial tool also, they have a lot of features to go in and address certain things, the complexity in the design. So we spend more time on, you know, again, the floor planning and also the placement routing until you meet the timing requirement. So then we go into the physical layout section here. So the physical layout, again, we go with, like, you know, DRC rule check. DRC is basically the geometry. When I say routing, we just route with metals, right? Metal, in the fabrication, the metal is mostly copper, okay? The old days, they used a lot of aluminum, but now it's actually mostly on copper. And then vias, maybe using a different material. So each and every metals, we have a design rule. For example, 28 nanometer or, like, you know, 16 nanometer or 7 nanometer, the thickness of the metal is actually defined by the fab process, like, you know, TSMC and also all the EDA people. Okay, so that thickness of the one metal layer, for example, is 0.07 micron, then there's a space between one metal layer to the another layer. There is a rule that you have to follow. So all the EDA tools are actually well equipped to take care of it during the placement and routing. But again, you know, if your design is really, really congested, there could be a chance that, you know, the tools creates a lot of DRC violations. Meaning, you may see so many metals maybe overlapping each other, or maybe placed too close or routed too close each other. So you may see a lot of spacing problem that you need to go and fix it. So those things we need to verify. Why we need to verify? When you deliver the final artwork GDS to, like, all the fab company, like TSMC, Intel, or, you know, Samsung, they will be running the check on their side and make sure that the design is completely DRC clean. If you see DRC violations, they will not take your design for the manufacturing. So you have to meet their design criteria. So you have to meet all the rules that, you know, they have put in their document. Same thing for the layout versus schematic. Like, you know, you have done everything nicely, but sometimes, you know, it happened in the industry. You might be using the wrong database to do all these things, right? So it could be possible, because when an engineer is working on, you know, multiple projects, or maybe, like, you know, doing a lot of other concurrent work, it could be possible that he may be choosing the wrong database to go and build everything. But if you don't do a proper layout versus kind of schematic check, that could be a possible that, you know, you are releasing the wrong GDS to the fab, you know, end up, like, you know, lose your job. Like, you know, it's going to be a lot of money. Okay? So you need to make sure that whatever the schematic version that we have, you know, started from the initial stage all the way to a final layout stage, you have to make sure that, you know, both are actually matching perfectly. Okay, then it's actually in the GDS format. GDS are actually the OASIS file. So we just, you know, transfer to the foundry, like TSMC or UMC, Global Foundries. So they will make the search, okay? Again, I think we have studied a bit on the fabrication, so you can go through the what are the fabrication process, how they make the chip. So that process takes some time. It takes like 133 days, 150 days. Nowadays, with the, you know, latest technology, with so many number of mask layers, you know, it takes more number of days from the date you deliver the, you know, GDS to the silicon that you will be seeing, like 150 days, 160 days later. Okay, and then once the silicon is back, okay, then what we do, we have something called a wafer test first. We do the wafer test. That means the silicon, we'll use the ATE tester machine to go and do a wafer test first and make sure that, you know, your chip is working, okay? Like, you know, what Balaji mentioned on the DFT insertion, right? The purpose of having DFT insertion is to make sure that your design can be tested later, right? So you have to test your wafer first, make sure that, you know, you have a good reasonable amount of, you know, the working silicon or working chip in the wafer. So once, you know, you identified what are the chips are really working, then we'll take the chip and then go for a packaging. Packaging is the one you all know, right? So it's like, if you look at the, any IC, you'll be seeing a component, just, you know, small pin just coming out. That's the package ball. We have like wire bond chip, or maybe you have a flip chip, like wire bond, you have a, you know, air connection from the chip to the outside PCB board. But mostly for the flip chip, like, you know, you just directly mounted, you know, on the PCB board directly. So nowadays we have even 2.5D packaging, 3D packaging with all the latest technology. And then, so once the package is done, again, you need to go and do one more test using the package test, because, you know, even though your wafer test, your silicon is passing, doesn't mean that, you know, after package test is going to pass. it could be possible that if the package design really goes wrong, you know, so you may see some failures. Let's say if the package balls are not attached properly, you may be seeing some opens in your design. So all these things you need to check again in the package test and make sure that now everything is working very fine. Then we will send this part to the end customer. So customer again take your part and put it to their PCB board. So whatever you have done so far is actually, you know, your test only. We are not doing any functional test, right? Because whatever you are doing is actually based on the DFT logic that you inserted, that you are verifying the chip is working fine. But when it comes to the customer, customer take this chip and put it into their PCB board, and then they will run their functional test and make sure that the chip is really working and, you know, it meets all their requirements. Okay, that's what the silicon validation they do. So once the silicon validation is done, most of the time, you know, they have their own end customer. They will send us a you know, full rack or maybe like, you know, like one PC they deliver to their customer, and then they will be using it. And, you know, they will run maybe like 100 days and make sure that, you know, everything works fine. Then they go for a mass production. For example, like, you know, if you look at Apple iPhones or like any high volume product, right? So this test needs to be like, you know, more strong, and it should be like, you cannot make even a single mistake. Like, you know, if you make a small mistake, you know, you would have seen, I read a lot of news about, like, you know, car companies, if you find some problem in the airbag or anything, they will, you know, ask you to recall all the cars to go and repair. You cannot do the same thing in the IC design job, right? The one small mistake, if you know, forgot to fix it or maybe forgot to identify or find it, then it's going to be millions and millions of parts will be just thrown, just wasted. It actually costs you a lot of money. So all this validation and also the testing is very, very important. Okay.
Yeah. One minute. Previous slide. Can you go? Yeah, I think Kannan sir asked a query, what is a bug actually? So the bugs are like, you have
Balaji, you start from the specification, you explain that, sir. Okay.
Yeah, so from specification,
Balaji, yeah. Can we go to the other slides so that you can have a better explanation, right?
Correct. Okay.
Thanks. Sir, we have you know, separate slides for each and every topic.
So yes.
Quickly, that will give you a clear picture.
Now, in this slide, my doubt is, as a VLSI design engineer, previous slide, please, previous slide. Well, as a VLSI design engineer, whether I have to be expert in all these stages mentioned in this flowchart, or I have to be expert in one or two stages in these slides?
So we need to be expert in one or two stages. A person can't be expert in all the domains, actually. So it is like each domain requires a specific skill. Okay. So typically, specification, architecture, and all is done by the experience, like 20 years, 25 years experienced guys in the industry. Once once they know that everything about the industry, then only they can do this job. So apart from that, like RTL coding verification, pre-silicon validation, everything can be done by junior level engineers also. But so you need to choose what field you are interested or wherever you are getting opportunity. No? So you need to get into that. Okay.
So you can become a domain-based specific expert only after entering into that company, isn't it?
Correct.
Yes. Thank you. Well, my another question about bugs.
Yeah.
See, Satish said there are some defects found after the manufacture. Why can't you validate before that manufacture? That is why you are here, to check the validation, testing, everything. After testing and validation, how can you say there is some defects when it is sent to the customer side?
There are the options, sir. There are the option where, you know, when we are doing the pre-silicon validation and post-silicon validation. So the topic is pre-silicon validation. If any bug found, then we can able to fix very easily, and we can able to solve the problem with minimum time. And Balaji already told that there are some software related stuff where we cannot able to validate in the pre-silicon side. Because pre-silicon side only we will do the specification, architecture, design, and till the synthesis side. And post-silicon, so after silicon tape out, then there are some timing related issues or there are some problem will come where we missed. So that is the reason we are doing the netlist verification. Because verification, there are two types of verification, functional verification and formal verification. And the third one is the netlist verification. So netlist is nothing but this is the form of silicon representation where we can able to take the netlist and we can do the verification. But the schedule will be the problem. So netlist verification will take more time when compared to the functional simulation. Functional verification. So considering all this stuff, front end and back end, we can able to do maximum. End of the day, time to market is also important, where you know all the mobile companies, a lot of companies are launching their product. And if you are missing that time to market terminology, then you will lose the huge marketing and business gap in the industry. So considering that also, the schedule that we have given is very less, and we will mainly will cover 99.9% before going into the silicon. But however, whatever you said is correct. In case one or two bugs we missed in the pre-silicon validation and netlist validation, all the validation, then after silicon came into the picture, we will do one more level of the validation. So that Sadhis told very clearly, after Foundry, GDS, we will do the one more level of validation. There also, if we didn't found, then only the problem will come into picture, like when you are using one of the mobile, some of the app is hanging, then I saw a lot of guys will restart that mobile. So once they restart that mobile, that issues will resolve. So that is kind of bug where we know during the chip manufacturing itself, we would have found and we would have fixed.
Sir, to answer your question, like we have all this process of validation. Once if it qualifies the validation and bug free only, the product will go to the customer. Okay. So if say if any of the bugs in the like before production, like if going to foundry, if it is found, it is good. But if after going to foundry, when you get the chip, and then if you bug are found in the like during software validation phase or post-silicon validation or during ATE, like where you screen the chip, there were some faults in the chip. So then you need to redo that process, everything again, like that chip is kind of is not worthy for manufacturing. So you need to go through that process again. That's where that huge, if you look at one tape out cost in the current technology is like $4 million or like $5 million in 16 nanometer, and in 7 nanometer it is even more, like $8 million or $9 million. So the foundry costs are huge to making a prototype type of a chip. So if any bug is found, there is no other alternative, you need to go back and redo the chip. So that's where jobs criticality is involved. Yeah.
So another continuation of this question, you are supposed to, you have manufactured and goes to the customer. If there is some defect or some bugs in the, say, 10,000 units is sold, now you are collecting it back, okay? One, you are collecting it back and you are supplying a new one. Now, my question is, why don't you make use of that 10,000 units to repair the bugs so that you can resell it, instead of whether it goes to waste?
Yeah, it goes to waste once it is manufactured.
Why? Instead of why don't you repair it?
No, you can't repair it, sir. That is a process technology, actually. So once the chip is manufactured, you can't repair the chip. So if there is a logic, see, there is no concept of recalling in the VLSI industry. So you can't recall it. So if they have, if it is, if a chip after say we should make thorough testing before releasing it to the customer, that every functionality they do, like 10th, like if you're releasing iPhone, no, the amount of checking they do for the chip is humongous actually. So there is no chance of escaping bugs. So have you ever heard Apple recalling iPhones? No, that is not possible actually. So it, in car industry, like in automobile industry, you can recall it and repair it, but in VLSI industry it is not possible. So only thing is that you need to do enhance your thorough testing. If it is a failure, then it is a bad name for your company. So if some, that's where, like if you are like, there are companies which you buy phones and if it does not work, that company goes bust. So there is no alternative for this. Yeah.
Okay. Please continue.
Okay. So just to add on one more thing quickly, I think sir question is valid. You know why we are not. We are, you know, all the whole industry is actually trying their best to identify the bugs as early as possible in the design cycle. But there are some cases. This general is advanced technology, right? So there are a lot of assumptions we made in the design, right? If sometimes when you go into the, like, you know, very advanced technology, if you make some assumptions, if the assumption is really wrong or maybe it is not accurate enough, there could be a chance that, you know, you see failures. And another thing, whatever you do is actually kind of some statistics analysis only that you are doing. Your real silicon behavior versus whatever you are doing the spice simulations, it is not necessary that you know every time it should match 100% perfect. You always see there is a 0.01 or 0.02% difference between your spice versus your actual silicon behavior, because there could be a lot of things happening in your the fabrication process as well. So sometimes that it happens, some then no choice, if customer returns the parts, we also do some lot of fault analysis. What sir said, we do fault analysis using the chip, but there's no way fixing the existing one. Unfortunately, you have to go for you need to order a new wafer and then you need to rebuild the whole thing. Again, you'll be wasting 150 days of your fabrication, again, go through all the testing again, ship the parts to the customer. It's again what Sangan mentioned just now, time to market. You may miss the window of this 3 to 6 months. You do the 6 months and customer takes another 3 months to do their validation. You miss 9 months because of the bug. Within this 9 months, maybe another company just starts selling the same product with a much better performance. Then your entire investment, $200 million or $1 billion that you invested for this market is this particular product is all totally wasted.
So another thing is that for the any new technology, they first, before going into the actual production, so every company, they make their own test chips, making the critical components to make sure that all of them are working in good condition and whether they are matching as per the design intent. So that is they will try to reduce as much as possible the defect rate, but it is sometimes it is not avoidable.
Okay, so this we can move on.
Next
slide. Please go on.
Coming back to, we will be briefly going over each of these steps which we going through that previous chip. So as I explained, the first step in the VLSI design process is the specification of a chip actually. So so this, how the specification of a chip is collected is based on the customer feedback. So based on the customer feedback or the marketing survey. Okay. So for the existing product, you take the feedback from the customer to find out what improvements you want to in your next version of the chip, what additional functionality you want, and what and all you want to pack more into a single stick solution. That's what they discuss. And in another, or if it is a totally a new product, which are out of the box thinking that there is a problem in the in this world I want to solve with this chip, then it is then you need to come up with entirely a new idea where you need to form a chip with a certain amount of components to resolve a problem with a particular set of applications. or particular set of particular area domain. So then during the like as this picture indicates, no. So whether you want to put certain components and throw out certain components based on your chip specification, my chip wants to support wireless, then like you need to have wireless. If you want to my chip wants to have Bluetooth, or my chip wants to have Wi-Fi, or if my chip wants to have graphics processing, so you decide based on your chip functionality what are the components to include and what are the components to remove. So what you need to find is a balance, is that you need to find a balance between your cost of the chip, your functionality of the chip, your power of the chip. So if you put more functionality and if your power becomes too heavy, then the chip is useless. So you need to you can't sell that chip to the customers, because power is huge, your battery will die down like within 30 minutes, then nobody will buy that product. So your innovation or your intelligence is something how I can put maximum functionality with the lesser power in lesser area. Okay, that's where your intelligence, and if you are able to make it, you will be paid high. So once you decide the specification, then you will once what components to in, what components to out, then the architecture team comes into that based on that specification. A specification is something like my chip has to operate like a right current chip is 2.5 gigahertz speed, so I want my new chip to operate at 3 gigahertz chip. The current chip does not support wireless, so my new chip has to support wireless. That is and all given by the marketing team. So but the architecture team, suppose if I want to include wireless, so what kind of wireless I need to include? Should I put 2G or should I put 3G? Should I put 4G or what kind of wireless functionality? And if you put Bluetooth, so there is a Bluetooth also has a 3G, 4G, 5G. So and then if you have Wi-Fi, you have 2.4 gigahertz wireless and Wi-Fi, or you have 5 gigahertz wireless. So which this chip requires which capability of wireless? Okay. So and then what is the performance of the chip, how much response time, if I open an app, how much response time I need to have, how much the memory the chip should have, so all these, and how much power this chip should have. So the specification team will say that my chip has to be say maximum consume 3 watt of power. Okay, so that architecture team has to decide which component if I use, so they have to put each and every component, they have to select meticulously so that the overall chip of the power does not exceed 3 watt. So that is the job of your architecture to find out the correct IP to include in the chip so that the chip specification is met. So is that clear? Yeah. So once the chip architecture is done, then it goes into a implementation phase. So there are two kinds of implementation phase, front end and back end. So till synthesis is a front end, and after synthesis, placement, routing, and everything else is there was a color coding in the previous slide. So the first column is a front end, the second column is a back end. So this RTL design and everything comes into the front end. So what is the RTL design? The meaning of the RTL design is register transfer level design. So what it does do? You need to capture the specification in high level design language. So I want to for simple example, my chip functionality is AND gate. If I give A and B input, so I need to get a AND gate output of C. Okay, that's my chip functionality. Okay, so there is a high level definition language which says that C equal to A and B. Okay, so that like that. You, so if you code it and then you just give it to a tool, then it will convert in terms of AND gate. So that's how the specification is converted into a high level description language. Okay. So the language to use to capture is like there are two kinds of languages. Like it is like our any programming language or C, C++ or something like that. So there are two languages called Verilog and VHDL. So using these two languages, you capture the design intent in terms of high level language. Like if I give this set of inputs, I need to give this set of outputs. So these languages provide capability, like it is different from other languages in the sense that it models the hardware. Okay, so other languages does not model the hardware, they are work on computation based, but these languages model the hardware. These two languages like Verilog and VHDL, no? So they model the hardware. And so what kind of hardware they model? There are like two, three different kinds of hardware, like combinational logic. So combinational logic is that if you give two inputs, the output will be expected in the same time instant. And there is a sequential logic. The sequential logic is something like the combinational logics are like AND gate, OR gate, or your MUX, adder, all of them are belong to the hardware logic. And the sequential logics are like you take information and you store it and you take it in the use it at some other time. So the sequential logics are something like flip-flops. So flip-flops can store a state of the input to some amount of time till the next clock. Or you can have it in memory, like SRAM or your DRAM memories, where you can store the content like for long amount of time till the point you want it, like till the point you erase it, that memory will be kept for your processing. And FSM is like is defining the control flow of a particular how the using this combinational sequential logic, how do I process the data so that I get the expected output. So if you understand like these three, combinational, sequential and FSM logic, you can kind of become a full-fledged RTL engineer. Okay. So and in the case of design, no, like how you make it is like you can't design the entire chip in a single day. Okay, so if in a complex chip, what we have is kind of a three stages of design called IP design. So IP design is like each component is small, each chip functionality is like if Wi-Fi is one, is one functionality, that is an IP. If Bluetooth is there, that is another IP. If USB functionality is there, that is another IP. And if your display functionality is there, that is another IP. So these IPs, either you can develop in-house or you can, like there are IP vendors which they can provide IPs, these design IPs, and you put that in your design as a, and then you build a subsystem, and you subsystem is like multiple components, multiple IPs put into a single logic domain. So, and then these subsystems are built into connected and made a full chip, which is called a top level design. Okay, and it is called top integration. So these are the stages in the logic design. Once logic design is done, so then you move into a verification phase. Okay, so in the verification phase, so you have a specification. Based on the specification, some engineer has designed that, has written the high level programming language. Whether that high level programming language is written as per the specification is the job of a verification engineer. Okay, so to verify that, what you can see a test bench diagram here, where there is a component called DUT. It is called design under test. So that is your, you can call it as a, your chip. Okay. So what you need to do is that to test that chip, whether it's as per the specification and it is correctly written by the RTL designer, is that you generate a stimulus, saying that as per the specification or the protocol which is given by the specification, I generate a sequence of input and I give it to my chip or DUT, and then I get the output. And you take the you capture the output through a monitor, and the monitor checks that whether the outputs are coming as per the protocol. And also based on your input, you have a based similar to the DUT functionality. Okay, you develop a scoreboard. If I give you input, my out, I will expect this output. So you will have a model kind of out component in your scoreboard, and you compare the DUT output and also your test bench output, and they should exactly match. If there is any error, then it is there are two things. One is the design has a bug. This is what it is called a bug, where the specification is not matching the design intent. So that's where the job of the verification engineer, he needs to find as much as bugs as possible in this stage. If you capture, if you are able to capture all the bugs, then in the post-silicon phase, you don't need to debug too much. The debugging a bug in the after silicon come up is very difficult because you don't know what happened wrong. So your stimulus generation and your scoreboard and our monitor should be very sophisticated, so that it should completely mimic what is the your chip behavior, and any chip intent which is captured by the high level definition language, it should be captured by your verification environment. So to aid this verification, so we have separate languages which is called system Verilog. And to aid in the scoreboard to write C models, so there is a language called System C, and there is using this to integrate all these components correctly, there is a methodology called UVM. So we use all these components to build the verification test bench. And once you build the test bench, so how do you debug? Actually, if something fails, okay, so where is the failure? How do you debug? Like you, there is a design is big, huge design, okay. So you given your inputs, you expected some output, it has not given the expected output. So you don't know where is the problem. Like there is like thousands of components in the design, so you don't know which component is misbehaving, okay. So there is something called a debugger, like a simulator. So you give these inputs, you using this language, you build this test bench, and you using a simulator, you simulate this test bench, and you generate a waveform of your input and output. And based on the waveform, you go and check that, like every stage of the design, I given this input to this stage, I got this output, whether this input and this output is matching. Similarly, next, so if it is matching, then go to the next stage. So maybe in the fifth stage, your input and output is not matching. Then there is some bug in the design saying that some specification is not handled correctly in the design. So that's how we debug. So there is like, this is the, there is a sample waveform shown in that in this green color waveform, where you can see all the outputs like of the chip. You can capture each and every signal within the design. You can view it and see it like where my design has gone wrong. Okay. So once your design is intent is captured and you verified that there are no bugs in the design, okay, then what you do is that now you need to go for a physical implementation. Okay, so before going to physical implementation, you need to convert your high level design language into the gate level, which can be physically implemented. So there are certain tools which can read this high level definition language and convert in terms of gates. So those tools are like each, there are main three vendors like Synopsys, Cadence and Mentor Graphics. These are the industry leading tool vendors where they do offer tools for design verification, synthesis, physical design till tapeout. They offer tools for all of the things. So either you can mix and match from these vendors based on like each tool's capability, or you can a single vendor's tool for everything. Okay, so so these the tools used for this are Synopsys Design Compulse, Cadence, Genus. So how effectively you are converting your design into a logic implementation is the tool's knowledge. Okay, how tool interpret that high level language. So and how can tool optimize it. So if your tool optimizes like a small amount of logic count for the same given RTL design, a tool can give 100 gates or a tool can give 90 gates, you can achieve the same functionality. So that is the intelligence built into the tool. So you need to select the tool based on like which performs better. Yeah, so Nathya, so now Satish will take over for the physical design part.
So we have some time constraint. I don't know. We can proceed as long as you know. You all just stay and listen. Anyway, I'll try to go through quickly. Okay. So before I go into the more detailed physical design, I just want to quickly talk about the physical design challenges. Okay. So what are the challenges you know we see today in the VLSI industry, especially on the latest technology? You know, most of us are working on like you know 7 nanometer. Then moving forward is going to be 5 nanometer technology here. Okay. So look at this chart here. You know what is the design cost starting from let's say 65 nanometer to the 5 nanometer. Okay, and also look at on the right side. You see how much is cost for the IP qualification, architecture verification, physical design, the software, the prototypes, and validation. So since I'm going to talk about more on the physical design, so the two things you need to take note. One is the physical design. You know, you can just guess, you know, how many millions is cost for this particular process technology, and also look at the prototype. Okay, so for a 7 nanometer, you know, it will cost you around like 6 to 7 million, you know, one prototype. So okay, so you know now how costly you know this VLSI market and also the chips are. As Balaji mentioned that, right? So the CMOS VLSI design has grown in complexity, starting from like you know a million transistor into now billions. So it's like hundreds of billions in this last 20 years. So okay, so as you know, the Moore's law continues to drive why the customer wants to go into the smaller node. If you look at this amount here, why I should move from one particular technology to the another technology. So we know that my cost is going to increase, but still why I want to move from one process technology to the another process technology. So as per the Moore's law, like you know, the number of transistor actually is double. And then if you look at this one, there is always going to be like you know less power and also the speed improvements from one process technology to the another technology. Okay, so the for the VLSI design, for a good design, our goal is very simple. We want to achieve a high performance, low power, and also the smaller area. Okay, so that low power, high performance, and smaller area, you can easily get it when you move into the next process technology with the cost of lot of complexity being added to the design. Okay. See, nowadays they don't want to build too many ASICs. Okay, what most of the customers are doing in a PCB board, if you look at you know the older technology, you'll be seeing so many smaller components. Nowadays, I think most of them they just want to have like you know one big full chip that has all the features built in. So that means like you know 4 or 5 ASICs actually is combined into a single chip now. That's why. The chip size is going to be like you know much bigger, and also the all the IPs and also the logic gates, all the functionalities also is getting more complex nowadays. Okay, and then whenever you move on to from one technology to the another technology, there's going to be a lot of design tool change, because the previous technology, the one particular metal width is like you know so some let's say is a 0.1 micron. Maybe the next technology is going to change to like you know 0.07. So it's very difficult for even the EDA vendors and also the experienced engineers to go and you know study what are the new rules they change in this new technology, and what kind of physical verification I need to do to understand each and everything. Really takes a lot of time, and also it's a lot of human resources to go and check each and everything, to go and find a solution and fix it. Another key challenge is the electromigration and IR drop and all the crosstalk and ice fixes. The electromigration, I think you all know, when the high current passing through a metal piece, that could be a possible that it can damage the metal, and it can create the open or shorts. And also same thing for the IR drop. You define a chip with some certain amount of power, but unfortunately, the one particular area, the standard cells are actually taking so much of power, then there could be a chance that actually you don't have a sufficient power to drive those cells. So you'll be seeing there's some weakness in some of the power grid area. So the moment you see more IR drop, the speed of this particular design is going to be it's getting weaker again, right? And also if your design is so congested, you see a lot of crosstalk and noise issues. Like I think most of our electrical engineers, I think you've seen transmission line, when you see two cables going very close to each other, you hear some noise, right? Same thing in the IC design also. When you have two metal piece, such as some long distance parallel nets, you'll be seeing there is some crosstalk delay between one net to the another net. Okay, when you start switching, you'll be seeing more noises. So all these things, when you go into the newer technology, we are seeing very critical, and it really takes a lot of time for us to go and find out the solution and also the fixes. So this is the main physical design challenges. Then I will move on to the floor planning. Okay, floor planning. This is the high level and also the full chip floor planning picture here. What is the input for the floor planning first? Okay. As Balaji mentioned in the previous slide, right, you synthesize a design. So now you got the gate model, right? So a floor planner will receive the gate models, all the gate netlist from the front-end designer or maybe from your customers. Let's say if my design is actually a 200 million gate count, right? Then marketing already finalized, hey, this is the die size that you need to work on with this size of the design. So you have given us some size, right? Let's say it's like 15 millimeter square by millimeter, 15 millimeter. Then we are trying to put together everything nicely, right? And also each and every chip, you have some high-speed IOs and like PLL, DDR memory, some HBM memory, and also the SerDes. All these things, based on the customer's PCB board requirement, you know where you're supposed to place those high-speed IOs and also the general purpose IOs. Whether you want to place it on the north side or south side or east or west, everything is actually decided by you based on the customer's feedback. They will tell you I have a connection from this chip to the another chip, it is placed on the right side. So I need to place my high speed IOs on the right side here so that my communication from the PCB board point of view is going to be perfect. I don't need to have a long routes in the PCB board. So you design all these things. And then let's say if it is a multiplexer block or maybe a one adder block or maybe one CPU smaller block. So those block aspect ratio also you are going to decide, right? So based on that particular design, how much space is required, what kind of aspect ratio that I'm looking for this design to fit into. So you decide all the blocks and also all the IPs placement and all the IOs placement in this floor planning stuff, right? Then the main key thing is the power grid, right? So you need to have in the when I started my career, all this, we have very less number of power supplies, mostly IOs in one supply, maybe the main core supply, the VDD supplies in another voltage. But nowadays with a lot of complex IPs, each and every IP now is works as different voltage. There's going to be so many voltage domain in the chip. And also sometimes, some of the area of the design, you don't want to use it for some function. For example, one chip, I want to use it for one function. And also maybe I can use it for some other function also, but I don't need these are the functionality in my design. So I can go and shut down those area, so that my chip will not take a lot of power, right? So they define a lot of multi-voltage and also the voltage island domains during this power planning stage. Then everything actually broken into a smaller blocks. Then that one will pass it to the block engineers. That is called the block, we call it as a block builders or the block designers. Like how you do the front-end coding, small sub-blocks, you do the RTL coding, same thing. all the small blocks will be handed over to the block designers. So what is the main objective of the floor planning, right? You have to make sure that, like, you know, you have to find the best optimum location for all your IPs, all the IOs, and also your blocks, and also to minimize the die size as small as possible, so that, like, you know, the die cost is going to be minimum, your company will be benefited a lot. So some of the tools that we use in floor planning, you know, the very famous is like Cadence SOC Encounter and also the ICC2 from Synopsys side. So this is the floor planning. So once the floor planning is done, you are given the, you know, the one particular small block to an engineer. So engineer is taking a block and then he started building the block. Okay. Before even he starts, you know, using the block, he has to make sure that if you look at the arrow mark here, the IO pins. IO pins means all the input and output pins. Meaning, input pin means there is some signal coming from the another block. For example, if you look at this picture here, the look at the red color box and also the yellow color one, there's going to be some communication between red and yellow. So the red blocks ports, IO pins will be placed at the bottom. At the same time, the same ports will be placed at the top side for this yellow blocks. So you can see here, you can see pins at the top and bottom are maybe sometimes left and right, depends on where your block is going to sit. So you should make sure that you have all the pins placed, and also if you have some hard macros in your design, for example, any custom IPs or maybe like some of the memories, SRAMs, you just need to do the custom placement, because even though the commercial pool can do a better placement optimization, but what we have learned, you need to have some, you know, fixed location for all the custom IPs and custom macros. So you need to do those placement first, then make sure that you have a proper power grid also laid down before even you start your placement. Okay, then what are we going to check in the placement step? So you have an input and output, right? So you have given a constraint from your timing person. Hey, what is my input delay and what is my output delay? That means how much time I can take from my, let's say the function of the multiplexing here, how much time I really need to do this data manipulation or maybe some ALU function here. So the top level timing guy will be giving some kind of you know, constraint to you. Hey, you can have maximum of, like, you know, 0.1 nanoseconds or maybe like, you know, 2 nanoseconds for this particular input pin and for the particular output pin. So you have given a constraints for all the input pins and output pins. So when you are running the placement step, the tool will do this auto placement. Okay, nowadays the tools are so smart. Okay, you don't need to do anything, because you're talking about, like, you know, tens of billions of per transistor. There is no way you can go and look at, you know, manually place one by one. No, but you know, the tool is so intelligent, it can able to go and place all the cells nicely. But you have to make sure that your design is not really congested. If you look at the picture here on the top here, I don't know whether you can see my cursor here, some red color and blue color, all this. That means there are a lot of logics placed, you know, in that area where, you know, I don't have enough space. So the tool is showing this is the congested or the hotspot area, meaning I need to give more space in this particular area for the logics to go and place it in this. So placement stuff, what you need to check basically, what is the placement density that I see in my design? Am I meeting my timing constraints that, you know, I have received? And also, whether my congestion looks okay or not with the acceptable limit. I think when you start doing it, you will know, you know, what is the number that I need to look for the congestion, whether it be based on this color code or based on this number, whether my design can able to route or not. Those things you will know when you start doing this. But that's what we do in the placement step. Again, Cadence, we have Innovus tool, and, you know, Synopsys, we have ICC2 placement. So for the clock tree, I think we all know what is clock, okay? If you look at any of the board, there is a clock generator, okay? It's a crystal oscillator. That is the one generates the clocks, okay? So the clock is a kind of a signal which oscillates between a high and low, okay? That means, you know, when you go high and low, basically it used to synchronize, it coordinates all the actions in the digital circuits. Okay? That's why if you look at a flop for an example, you know, we know flip-flop is actually a edge-triggered storage element. Okay, so let's say if it is a positive edge triggered flip-flop, when the clock goes high, it saves the data. Then, you know, when it goes to the next cycle, it just transfers the data, right? So the clocks are very, very important for the design. That is the one decides, you know, what frequency or like, you know, what is the maximum performance that you are looking for your particular design. So this particular clock tree synthesis, our aim is to minimize the clock skew. When I say clock skew, and also the clock latency. Look at your left hand side. You know, this is what, you know, what Balaji said just now. When you synthesize the netlist, you see the logical connection is something like this. That means you have a clock. CG is actually a clock gator. Clock gator is mostly we use it for the low power design. You know, sometimes if you don't want to use certain function of this, you know, sub block, we can just enable this clock gator, then disable the all the clocks going to this particular circuitry. So in the synthesis netlist, you will be seeing a clock port that is driving this many number of flip flops, right? But when it comes to the physical design side, you need to build a proper clock tree structure. Okay, so when I say the insertion delay, that's the clock latency. If you look at the clock pin, the green color, all the way going to the clock pin of the flip flop, right? For this particular case, you can see each and every flip flop is actually seeing three buffers. Okay, normally we used to build with buffers and inverters for the clock tree synthesis. So you need to have a properly balanced clocking structure. And then even though it's actually you are balanced with the same number of buffers, sometimes because of your routes and, you know, all the PVT process variations, you'll be seeing some difference between flip-flop A getting you know, delay of, let's say, is receiving like 1.5 nanoseconds. Maybe another flip-flop at the bottom may be receiving 1.52 nanoseconds. That means there is a skew of 20 picoseconds difference between the clocks. That's what we call it as a skew. It's the maximum insertion delay versus the minimum insertion delay. That is actually the skew of the clock. Okay, so the aim is you're supposed to have a lesser skew and also the lesser insertion delay. Okay, moving to the routing. Once the placement and, you know, clock tree build is done, then we are going to the routing. Routing is basically, you know, you are making a physical connection from one cell to the another cell. But if you look at the bottom here, if you have input port going to a buffer, going to another buffer, then going to an output. So buffer has only two pins. One is the input and one is output. So you are making a connection from the input port. Port is your block boundary. The previous slide I show you, the I/O pins. You are making a connection from that port to all the way to the buffer's input pin. Again, the buffer's output pin to another cell and then another cell. Maybe in general, let's say if it is running at a 1 gig clock frequency, you may be seeing in the range of close to 30 to 35 combinational cells before it hits the clock. Okay, I think normally in an average, any combinational cell will takes a delay of close to like, you know, 15 to 20 picoseconds delay. So you can have a logic depth of like, you know, 30 to 35. So the tool will know exactly, because based on the constraints, the tool will know, okay, this is my critical path, or maybe this is the high performance signal that I need to, you know, route first, or maybe I need to use the thicker metal layers to go and route. When I say thicker metal layer, means, you know, thickness of the metal layer is wider, because the moment you have the wider one, your resistance will be less. The resistance is less, you know, automatically it will fasten your data. Okay, the delay. The picture you see, some the orange color vertical one and also the horizontal maroon color one. These are the power signals. Normally, powers, we always use wider metal layers. For the signals, if you look at the green color and red color are the one, we call it as a metal layers. Okay, I think here the green color is metal 3, and then red color is actually the metal 2. Okay, again, I said right, metal 1 to up to the latest technology, mostly we use the copper metal during the fabrication process here. So then during the routing, we divide into like two parts. One is the global route. Global route will tell you basically what signal and, you know, and what metal layer I supposed to use. It will assign which metal layers to be used for this particular signal. When it comes to the detailed routing, is the one it makes the real physical connections. Again, with it takes a lot of, you know, other inputs like what is the spacing requirement, you know, is there going to be a noise driven and also the timing driven. So it takes everything into consideration to do the routing. Then once the routing is done, you need to go and see, make sure that my design is fully routed. Let's say if I have like, you know, 3 million nets in my design, for example. When I say net, means if you look at the bottom picture here, one buffer to the another buffer, there is a wire, right? The wire, we call it as a unique net name for each and everything in the design. So So you need to make sure that all the nets are completely routed. Okay, if you see some opens, meaning your design is really congested, the tool can't able to make some connection here, right? So you need to go and check, and also you check the routing DRC. Am I seeing like, you know, reasonably handful of DRC that I can fix it later, or I see, you know, millions of DRC where my design is really really congested that I can't able to do the routing at all. So that one you need to go and check everything carefully and make sure that your design is fully routed. Okay, once the routing is done, then we are going to like, you know, some, we do the RC extraction, then we go to the timing analysis here. So what is timing analysis? Okay, is the timing is actually the method of validating the performance of a design. Okay, it checks all the paths in the design. For example, if you look at the path starting from you see, you have a path from A to the first flip flop, and the first flop to the another flop is the path number 2, then another flop to the output port. And also, there is some combinational path also from the A all the way to the Z is through only the combinational, there is no flip flop at all. Okay, so you need to go and check what is my input delay and what is my output delay, and based on my frequency, am I going to need timing for this design? That's what you are checking. I think one of the famous interview question in VLSI design, what is setup time and hold time? Because basically, once you are done with the place and route, exactly what I am checking, right? So of course I do all the geometry check, violation, everything. In terms of timing point of view, what I supposed to do. So you check basically the setup time and hold time. There are so many other things like, you know, transition, X-cab, all these things. We don't need to go more in detail here. The key thing is about the setup time and the whole time you need to understand very carefully. So I just put a simple formula here, what is setup time? The setup time is actually, you know, there is a clock to queue delay. For example, if you look at the first picture, first flop, okay, there is a clock going to the queue. That means clock to queue is actually, there is an internal delay within the flop. Okay, there is a clock to queue. There is a delay within the flop. And also there is a combinational gate. If let's say if we have a 20 level of combinational gates, MUX, you know, buffer, inverter, adder, whatever it is, right? We have that one. Plus, there is a setup time requirement when you build any standard cell, like in a flip flop, latch, or anything. So there is a setup time for the flop. That add up all these things should be less than your clock period. Let's say your clock period is actually 1 nanoseconds, right? 1 nanoseconds is going to be like you need to go and see how much, basically, if the clock period is 1 nanoseconds, your data arrival time should be less than 1 nanoseconds in a very simple way to calculate. That means if you look at the picture of the below, your data should be stable and also before the rising edge of this clock period. That's what, how much time you need, that is your setup time requirement here. I think, you know, it's going to be the same for the whole time. After the clock period, you know, you should have a certain amount of time, your data should be stable. That's the whole time. Again, the formula, you have a clock to queue delay plus your logic gates should be greater than, you know, the whole time of the particular flop and also the clock queue. I think the clock queue that I mentioned the previously, right? So you may have so many routes, you may have some difference between one clock routes versus the another clock routes, max versus min, that's going to be the skew. Okay. So STA is very important because this is the area where you need to check most of, I think people sometimes, let's say you forgot to check some interface, some timing path. So what conundrums are asked, right? Your chip code is going to fail, right? You know, if you just forgot to check some of the log files, some of the report file carefully where you see some violations, maybe you are just taking a, you know, some wrong decision that, okay, this one is a marginal failure, you know, I can ignore, maybe it should be okay. Unfortunately, when the silicon comes back and when they do the test, maybe that particular design fails, you know, the entire chip will be wasted. So you have to be very careful in looking at this STA here. Okay, then the backend verification again, we have a lot of foundry people will give you so many rules, the geometry rules. What is the spacing between the two metal layer and what could be the VI enclosure, what is the minimum area, all kind of rules. If everything is there in the rule, you can run the tool and make sure that, you know, they use all the rules and you don't see any violations. L is the layout versus schematic that I explained to you before. And then we have a gate netlist formal application, right? So what Balaji mentioned, you have RTL design. Now you have a layout design, completely place and route is done in the design. You need to make sure that that RTL design versus this layout netlist, the functionality is at least matched, okay? Same thing for the gate level simulation also. there are certain things we cannot verify in the formal, you know, it has to be verified only in the functional simulation. And also we have a test and ATPG simulation here. This one we just need to make sure that, you know, all the scan chains are correct in the design. Okay. And then quickly, fabrication. Okay, once you deliver the final artwork database, we call it as a GDS, to the fab company, they will fabricate the chip. Okay, then they will send the chip back to you. Then we do the testing here. If you look at the picture at the bottom, right? So how the wafer looks like, you know, if you look at the circle on picture here, right? Whatever you see, the small, the square shape on these are the chips. Okay, so this wafer, we can just take it to the wafer test directly in the ATE tester machine. We do the wafer sort, we do all the wafer test, and then we will identify all the working wafers. So if you look at the next picture here on the green color means this chip is working. On the edge, you see red color and, you know, and yellow and orange. These are the failure chips. So in a one particular wafer die, depending on your die size, you can have, like, you know, 30 to 40 dies to all the way to 100 to 150 dies per wafer. Okay. So out of that, how many chips are working, we call it as a yield. Okay. But you are supposed to see more passing chips so that, you know, you don't lose money. Then you go into the package. You see the package parts here. After the packaging, it goes into your PCB board. Okay, the DFT, quick one, you know, if you look at the left-hand side picture here, this picture is actually without the DFT insertion. On the right-hand side is the with the DFT insertion. What you see, there is a mux added, okay? The symbol, what you see, that, you know, the shape is, we call it as a mux. I think the engineering college, we have studied the Boolean algorithm and everything function here. So mux, you all know, when the scan enabled signal is zero, it takes the D0, basically it goes to an output. When the scan enable is one, actually it takes the other input to go out. So what we do, when you insert the DFT insertion, you need to make sure that you can differentiate between the functional path versus the scan path so that you can test the chip later. So when you put in the functional mode, you just put the scan enable to zero. When you want to test the chip, you know, you just set the scan enable to one so that you can able to test this. So what is the meaning of testing here? Basically, you just give a random pattern of zero, right? Then you just shift all the registers with certain number of cycles at the end to see on the output. Let's say if I give the pattern of 1011, whatever the pattern, you're supposed to see the same pattern at the output side. If you don't see the similar pattern, there may be something wrong with your design. Somewhere it could be a hold time issue, or it could be, you know, something else. Or it could be sometimes your pattern generation also could be wrong. You need to go and find out the root cause, you know, why my test failed. You know, if it is a real failure, then we need to go and debug. You know, is it a design problem or is it a manufacturing problem? It's going to be like a lot of people will involve and do all kind of checks. Okay, that's what we do the testing. I think we don't need to go through this one. I think this one also biology covered a bit. So I will skip this one. Okay. The semiconductor process technology roadmap, you know, I just put 2001 here. I started off my career here. I started off with 180 nanometer. Then now I'm doing 7 going to 5. You see here. Okay. So you can see every 2 to 3 years, you see there is a change in the process technology. But what I heard recently, like, you know, the 5 nanometer is not going to be like, you know, every 3 years can go change to 2 nanometer. 5 nanometer will stay for at least, you know, some more years. Okay. So at least you can, now you can, you know, think of yourself. If I choose this field, you know, what I'm going to do for this, you know, I may, you know, get a job in this next few years. How long this, you know, market is going to be there, and, you know, do we have a bright future if I go with the VLSI design? Okay. So I think we have discussed enough. There are a lot of domains, you know, then a technology where, you know, everything I can say is actually is easy design. So there's going to be a lot of opportunities. And then even though the curve you see from starting from that down, this is not the downfall of this. This is the technology advancement, you know, going to the deep submicron technology. So this technology will be there forever. So that's what I wanted to tell you this right here. General discussion, if your time permits, then we will come back and discuss about this general discussion. Other than that, you know, we'll move into Sangharan, go through quickly on the opportunities in the years.
Thank you, Sadish. See, what are all the job opportunities in the VLSI design? Okay, I have decided to study the VLSI, and I got to know that something like design, front end and back end, and I have the basic knowledge about the VLSI. So what do you mean by design? What do you mean by verification, front end, back end? Because basically whatever both Balaji and Sadish covered is entirely with respect to the VLSI industry, front end and back end. So if your student's point of view, I'm just going to little bit level of the student's point of view, because student's mindset is something like after completion of the college, where I will get the job opportunity when compared to IT industry and this VLSI industry. So where we can able to, you know, explore a few of the things. So whatever we have covered is the entire full life cycle, like starting from the spec to GDS2. So Kannan sir also in between asked, suppose one student, you just think of it, one PE student is entering into the VLSI industry, then he must want to know from the spec to GDS2, the answer is no. So what else we can able to, you know, explore, or we can able to give some opportunity, job opportunity to the fresher. Then there are certain conditions. See, whatever we have so far discussed is in this slide. So recovery, metal, latency, diffusion, removal, design, verification, front end, back end, EDA, Slack, DRC, LVS, drain, debit. If I say all these things, students will not able to understand because they are the student. So once the main agenda for this particular seminar is to create the awareness, to the students level that how do we going to you know, generate the manpower. So that the manpower generation is very, very important. Student is completed the BTech and then they can able to go into any industry because they are the basic engineers. So they can go into the IT industry or they can go into the VLSI industry. Now coming back to our VLSI industry, what are all the opportunities? So is it necessary that only engineer directly enter into the VLSI industry, or he want to do some additional courses after engineering college study course completed, or during the engineering college course also? So these are all the examples. We, myself, Balaji, Sadish Abraham, lot of guys during our days, 94-98, we have completed the engineering college, and then we started searching this job, and then we found, okay, we do have the job or opportunity in this VLSI industry. So we studied the courses, all are studied the courses, and then we joined in the VLSI industry. And last time also I told, once you joined into the VLSI industry, the industry will take you almost around 20 years we are in the VLSI industry. So that kind of information I'm going to cover in this topic. Yeah, so this is the next slide. You can go there. So this is the one. So that is the main point. Every one, when we, myself and Balaji, used to visit the colleges, there is a question like, why VLSI industry reluctant to hire the freshers? So why? That is the question mark. So if you are seeing any kind of companies are coming from the IT department or from the VLSI side, the hiring is bulk hiring is happening in the IT industry. So the students level, they are thinking, okay, IT industry have a lot of opportunities. VLSI is very less. That's why those guys are hiring huge number of engineers. And this company is very less engineers. It is not like that. That is not true. That's what we both, we all three covered. What are all the job opportunities in this industry? So every student, those who are interested in this VLSI industry, we have to know about the experience level, or how you are going to gain the experience level to hire the VLSI industry. So that is the issues in our system, because our education system, recently only I came to know that our education system is little bit have changed to add into the VLSI field industry, into the subject also, and then the knowledge where, you know, during this course of study itself, what are all the job opportunities and knowledges, they have started calling the outside experts, industry experts, and giving this web seminar. All these kind of things started to give to the students, so that students get aware of the things, what are all available in the industry. Yeah, of course, they have smartphone in their hand and they can search everything. But these are all the things is not available in the any of the Google. Even you can able to, students can able to search and they can able to find it. No information available, whatever we have shared right now. So the knowledge gap. So how much knowledge students have during this course of engineering, and after completion of the things, what is they are going to do? They do not have any knowledge about the VLSI industry. So the company also, right now, Kanan sir also asked, what are all the companies involved in the VLSI industry? Main company like Intel, everyone are telling Intel, Qualcomm, Broadcom, some maybe 5 companies or 8 companies, something like that. They know about that name of the company. VLSI industry, VLSI chip manufacturing company. But apart from that 5 to 8 company, we all are in this industry around 20 years. Too many companies are involved in the VLSI industries, either chip manufacturing or product manufacturing or service industry. So we have to get into that, we have to create that awareness, so that they can able to understand, okay, these are all the things is happening in the industry. Then, the last point of what I have captured is also very good. So because not many experts from the VLSI industry, especially in the VLSI industry, they are not ready to share their experience and knowledge. That is the point we identified. That's what we all are started doing, these webinars and seminars and face-to-face discussion to share our knowledge. We have experience in the industry, and we have to share that experience and the industry things to the students to get aware of their career path, because how they are going to choose their own career path, that very much important, this kind of webinar, seminar, to their knowledge extend that, and then they can able to start their career. So technology front completely Balaji and Sadhis covered. So I would like to just cover this kind of opportunities, and then where we can able to start the students can start look into that opportunities. So yeah, Sadhis. So that this is the things, you know, basically one IT candidate and one VLSI candidate. So all the VLSI candidate, you know, they know VHDL and Verilog. They will say that apart from VLSI and Verilog, you know, how many languages are involved? When I started my career, you know, first what I know is VHDL, because VHDL that time it was very, very typed language, very high language, they told me. So we were studying in the VHDL and we got the job and enter into it. The moment we entered into VLSI, they told, no, Verilog language is the best language, one of the industry standard. It is user friendly. Then we started studying the Verilog language also. Then after they are telling like, you know, move into verification, because apart from the design verification side, a lot of opportunities. So I just moved into verification side. Then they were telling, no, Vera is the one of the best language, because they have a lot of, rather than VHDL and Verilog, a lot of constraint, a lot of features extra additional into the Vera, where, you know, you can able to do this, that randomization, all those stuff. So we started reading the Vera and studying the Vera. Then one particular point of time, they told me like, you know, Spekman E is the best language where, you know, a lot of object-oriented OOPS concept is involved. We can able to do whatever we want. The C language have the OOPS concept. So same kind of things are added into it. And the technology also kind of OVM technology, they told that. So I started, okay, fine. It's good that we can start reading or studying the Spekman E. I studied and survived in the industry for some time. And then they were telling, no. System Verilog is the one of the language where, you know, three EDA industry companies like Synapsys, Cadence, and Mendergraph is joined together. They are developing the language called the System Verilog that is very, very good in the industry. So I started studying the System Verilog. Then they introduced recently the technology OVM to UVM, Universal Verification Methodology, where, you know, we cannot able to escape all the bugs because of this methodology. If you are following, then all the issues, problem will be captured in the pre-silicon verification itself. So now we are studying in SVUVM, and then to future, we don't know what kind of technology, what kind of languages will come into picture for the verification point of view, where I have covered it. So why I want to tell all these things is like, you know, once engineering college is over, we got a job, that's it. We don't want to update or we don't want to refresh our knowledge. That is not true. That's what I would like to say, that yeah, engineering college completed and I got a good job in good salary and I got settled in my life. So we Balaji and Sadis also, we started, and then how many technology, Sarish told that when he started, the technology was 180. Okay, 180 nanometer to now, Sarish are recently working in the, what do you call it, 5 nanometer technology. You just think of it. 182 to 5 nanometer technology, and recently I saw one of the things Sarish worked on it, and it is manufactured in the industry. Kind of what do you mean by technology? The students want to aware of it. So when they want to enter into the VLSI, the digital knowledge is important or not, that is the basic building foundation for the VLSI student. If you want to enter into VLSI technology, then digital design is must. Without digital design knowledge, you cannot able to survive in the industry. So basic question will ask, you know, kind of all the industry level things will come up with the digital design and the digital knowledge only. So that is the one where we know when we were studying that the CDAC courses were very, very powerful and very, very other topics covered in it. But what I did, you know, I have resigned my job and then I joined in the CDAC courses, 6 month full-time courses in the VLSI industry. That much I was having the confident about this VLSI industry. Then after completion of the VLSI industry, I didn't got job also for another around almost 2 years. And then I got the job and then I was here and I'm giving this kind of webinar to you guys. So this is the way, you know, the awareness about the job opportunities and what kind of jobs are available in the VLSI industry. It's very huge, very huge. But they are not aware of it because no one is sharing their knowledge and experience to students level. Initially, we 3-4 years we never thought that we have to give this kind of seminar and kind of knowledge sharing session to the student where, you know, they can aware of the industry point of view rather than studying. So once they completed the course of engineering college, what they are going to do is very, very difficult nowadays because of the competency level. So the competency level is very high between the students. So when we can ask, like, you know, so VLSI is only for the EEE students, my answer is no. Because electrical and electronic students are there, electronics and communications, and now computer science students also can able to join in this VLSI industry if they have the digital design knowledge and ready to focus on the concept wise. So that is one of the point now. So this is the industry versus academic, where the gap between the students and the semiconductor industry. So the academic syllabus, you can see very straightforward. You can see that digital running, analog running, semiconductor versus CMOS, all the basic microcontroller knowledge, all those stuff is there. But job opportunities in the VLS industry, they used to ask, you know, fresher trained in the design, freshers trained in the verification, and freshers trained in the layout design, or CAD engineers, or the PD engineers. So there is the small gap between the student and the open position in the industry. So the gap have to be filled by the only there are coursing. This thing is the companies where, you know, all the companies where they are offering the courses in terms of VLSI in CDAG, or a lot of other companies, institute are available in the market. They are giving completely about that industry. There is the gap, right? That gap they are filling apart from the technology, the 5-nanometer technology and chip design and the chip verification, and then awareness, and then salary. So these are all the things where, you know, we can able to cover as of now with this time of seminar. And the students, those who are interested, very much interested, they want to go into VLSI, they have decided to enter into VLSI industry, then they can contact Ramprasad sir, Kanan sir, and Vedavati, so that we can able to take up a separate session, or we can give a more detailed and in-depth knowledge and things like that about the VLSI industry. Because I know that this is very heavy to the students level. So students, you know, when we started this seminar, around 70 members participation, 70 plus, now it is almost around 30. So that's all from my side. I can able to give this presentation. So the last slides, I think one more slide is there. Sorry. Yeah. So these are all the things already we have covered, right? The concept of building and basic knowledge building, and SATM courses and certification. So otherwise, if somebody is interested in the master degree or reputed college or universities like KLN College of Engineering, and a lot of other colleges are available, then internship and project training. And then we have to try in the industry. So we have to keep try in the industry, and then we have to do all the things with respect to the VLSI industry, right? So the keep patience, and once you got into it, and definitely you will be, your life will be settled in this industry like other industry. This is a lot of opportunities are available. You have to explore. You have to do that, explore that things. That's all. Sorry. You are in mute.
Okay. Thanks, Angra. I think we can take up some questions if they have anything.
Okay, Sadish, thank you for your presentation, Sadish, Sankaran, and Balaji. Very, very nice presentation. So after seeing this presentation, I chatted proud of engineers and proud of engineering. So engineering is the ocean. Okay. So understood that the what way we have contributed a lot for the society. One, the reason for the students' participation, there are students having a less data usage. There are certain limitations on the data usage for our students, and more particularly for Madurai region, this lockdown is allowed up to morning 6 a.m. to 6 a.m. to 12 or 12 noon. Okay, so in these conditions, most of the students will be going for some other areas to pick up some grocery items. So they may be largely involved in going out, but after 2 p.m. everyone will be settled. So these are some of the reasons they may not be joining. Okay, actually this presentation should have been done in three parts. Sadish Balaji in at least 1 or 1.5 hours, and Sadish Abraham for 1.5 hours, and Sangaran to be given for 1.5 hours. This is the 3 days you should have conducted. So yes, that is why 3 days, very not heavy. Very heavy, very heavy. That is why initially they may most of the students, but you see our students' attitude. When we have asked the students to participate in Java programming for 10 days continuously, nearly 80 students out of 100 students participated for 10 days program continuously in last 2 years. Okay, so there are certain cases the students should be actively participated, more interested, more attitude students. There are a lot of examples are there. But this period is not due to certain instructions in limitation, they are not attending fully. Okay, definitely we will make use of this presentation for the betterment of the students. Now, you mentioned about the students, what they are studying and what is the industrial expectation and yes. What is the gap. Now, yes. We have an autonomous system. We become autonomous system. This autonomous system, immediately we cannot get anything now. Okay. It takes nearly 2 or 3 years. And within that 3 years, what we are going to try to do is that we are going to bring a lot of industrially expert person to participate in the curriculum. Okay. Now they will be teaching the subject as well as they will do the practical. They will set up, they will be sitting in the college for nearly 10 days to 15 days. So they will be the part of the curriculum. They will be part of the laboratory. So automatically the student, interested students, at least 10 to 20 students from each branch will be definitely get into this kind of VLSI technology. Okay. This assurance I can give. Okay. Vedadi, you want to talk anything? Veda? Again, I left during the meeting because of an important call. So these are some things happen. Okay. Any other questioners? Christopher?
Yes, sir. You said that we can do some additional short-term courses for VLSI. What kind of courses can I do, sir, after engineering or from now on itself?
There are a lot of courses available in the industry. There is the government organization name called the CDAC, or the private organization in Bangalore and in Chennai also. Lot of organization available, and we can able to go into that. And but as Kanan sir told, whether we need to have all the complete knowledge may not be required as of now, because student level, while entering into that VLSI industry, entry point is required. So after that, we will move into complete full scope of the VLSI industry. So while entering into it, whether you are going to the front end or back end, the two things is there. So you can choose yourself, or you can get the advice from your friends or your family circles or your relatives are working in the VLSI industry. You can get the advice. So if you want to enter into the front end, there are the two things is there, design and verification.
I want to enter into the back end, sir. I'm interested in back end.
So it is very good that at least you guys are aware that front end and back end. So back end, there are things like DFT, PD, or PV, or Sadish Agram will give you whole idea about the back end.
Sadish. Sure, sir.
One minute. I'll go to the...
Yeah, this is the slide.
See, the back end itself, like the one of the key challenges when you go into the back end immediately is like how much you get training before you enter into the back end is actually very important, because you know the art you know, cost is very high, right? Not all the training centers that can license to go and train you, hey, how you should do the placement, you should do the routing. I know some of the EDA companies, they give some temporary license for some of the institutes and colleges, but not everyone. The important thing is, you know, how much you are familiar with the tools. That is very important. Nowadays, a lot of things available in the website. You can go and find out. Most of the time, you know, you use your knowledge how to use this tool, you know, to make your job done. That's it. That's the key thing that you need to learn, right? So everything is available, except there are a few cases you may not find any solution from the tool that you need to apply. But most of the time, you should know how this tool is working, you know, what should do, and how to make use of these things to, you know, get it done on time. So that's the thing. Background training before you go into that background, I mean, the physical.
So here, here you can see that specification to synthesis is front end. After synthesis, there is the color changes, static timing analysis to gate level simulation, and this side completely there is the color changes. So these all are called back end.
Okay, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So thank you. Thank you, sir.
Yeah,
sir.
Any other questions?
Yes. Remember, very useful presentation. Okay. The students கொஞ்சம் ஃபுல் ஃப்ளஜ்டா வந்த பிறகு இன்னொரு தடவை பார்க்கேன்
ஃபுல் ஃப்ளஜ்டா no problem. அதாவது you just you know get some feedback from them, like, you know, there are too many things involved here from, you know, their students point of view. What informations are they really looking for the VLSI side? Then, you know, they can prepare only those. See, I have one slide that I really wanted to talk about for the bigger group, but, you know, not with the smaller one. I don't want people to think that, like, you know, this is the one I just put as a general discussion, but I think we don't have time now. So I think we need to have a bigger audience to listen, because everyone thinks that, you know, I studied in KLN College, you know, not in IIT or maybe REC or like Anna University, I'm going to get a job.
Nothing is required.
Things, you know, thinking in their mind, right? Then when it comes to like work, you know, how the company is, you know, looking at you. You are you looking for hard working people, or you want to look for, you know, smart working guys? You know, how to do the work efficient way, like, you know, productive way, and, you know, what is teamwork? For me, like, you know, the work is basically only two things. One is for the passion, one for the money, right? So at least that particular student age, until, you know, you get married and all these things, you should work for some passion. You should have that kind of interest, right? These are all technical stuff. This is not something that, you know, you go into, maybe you do a mechanical engineering then go into software. No such things here. You studied something in your engineering college, then you are applying the real knowledge into the field that where you are going to, you know, explore your career and, you know, be part of the industry. So you should have that kind of passion and interest first, you know, to go into this kind of design, because there's a lot of things involved. It's a pure technology, and, you know, a lot of knowledge that you can learn, and also you can apply a lot of your knowledge to this industry as well.
Thank you, Sadish. எனக்கும் டேட்டா காலி ஆயிட்டு இருக்கு.
Okay, sir.
Okay, sir. No problem.
Okay. We will make you, sir. Jayamurugan, கொஞ்சம் conclude பண்ணுப்பா.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Good afternoon, sir. First of all, I thank your management, respected principal and head of the department for the conduction of this webinar. I thank our session Balaji Sami sir, Ankaran Ram Sami sir. Very thank you, sir. Mr. Satish sir, thank you so much, sir. Thank you to share your knowledge of experience about VLSI design, architecture, and recent trends and job opportunities in VLSI design. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. Thank you for your valuable speech. And I thank our coordinators, Dr. T.R. Vedavathi ma'am and Mr. Manu sir. I hope all the students are ignited by information and awareness. Thank you one and all, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thanks everyone for joining. Okay, thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you so much. Bye.